I haven't seen that one, actually.
Oh, you will.
Yeah, I don't think so, but that's cool. Hey, everybody, welcome to another episode of the Geek Bytes podcast. I'm Ramon Mejia.
I'm Edgardo Acosta.
And every single week, we bring you the round of the week's best geek and tech news. We discuss that news and, of course, anything else that we're interested in that week. And this week, we're going to be talking about
Uber's secret program, Xbox streaming, Inhuman and X-Man TV casting, our review of the Nintendo Switch, movie trailer showdown, and much, much more.
Absolutely. And of course, beginning the show, though, with Geek News.
Hey, real quick with me, Hans. I'm having trouble waking up because I worked a...
He works nights.
A double gig. Yes, yeah. Almost 16 hours and only getting 4 hours of sleep. I don't know how Batman does it.
Yes, Batman is weird. I mean, Batman can sleep 4 hours. I don't know that I could.
Three or 4 hours and still be awesome.
And then, of course, Batman. The kid. And so even the sleep time is not as awesome and refreshing. So, yeah. But that's Hans Limu in the chat room is asking us why we need to wake up.
That's my personal life.
That's the reason, guys.
Let's get back to the geekiness.
Yes, though. So we got some interesting tech news to start the program off this week. Uber, and this is kind of a cool spy story almost.
Yeah, the New York Times broke the story this week that Uber has a secret worldwide program called Grayball. To hide from the government employees looking to catch Uber drivers operating in violation of local regulations. The Grayball program, which is reportedly approved by Uber's legal team, remains in use today and is part of the global operation to stop people from, in Uber's eyes, using its service improperly. The operation is called Violation of Terms of Service, or VTOS, which addresses everything from competitors looking to disrupt Uber's operations to law enforcement looking to catch violators of government taxi regulations.
Yeah, so this is not a huge surprise to anybody who's ever seen Uber's tactics, which like jumping into a city, whether they have a legal, clear legal path or not, and just like starting your programs up and then like fighting legal battles later, but like at least getting the revenue generated in those cities. And this has happened around the world plenty of times, but this is the first time that it's been actually proven that they have a secret double program that kind of looks for cops and other regulators who are trying to shut them down and denies them access to the program. And apparently it's legal because they have a terms of service. And so I think it's such an interesting, it feels like something you'd see either in like a James Bond movie, the Grayball program, or like on like NCIS, like one of those weird episodes or something. So it feels like something straight out of Hollywood. Yeah, exactly. Hans Lim in the chat room says Grayball, really? And yeah, we said the same thing, man.
It's the whole concept of the man trying to keep the little man down. You know, trying to avoid, you know, they're doing everything by the book as much as possible, but it's business and it's a business.
Oh, no, yeah.
Tactic.
Uber stretches that book, though. Like, they intentionally stretch the lines of, like, what's legal.
Mm-hmm.
Intentionally. Like, their intention is to disrupt the taxi industry. And so, if there are laws in place, like, they don't mind breaking them or bending them as much as possible. Like, they're more than happy to go into a courtroom and say, we have a legal right to operate our business. We're not taxi service, we're ride-sharing service, or whatever they're going to say. But their intention is to push out taxi companies to steal business from them and create a space for themselves. And I think that's a good thing because it advances that business side of it.
That's why I love, I'm not sure if you're a big South Park fan, but there was a whole episode about the whole Uber-ish ride-sharing service program. The whole concept was called Handy Car with Timmy. You know,
no, I don't think I've seen that episode. I'm not watch a lot of South Park.
Oh.
I mean, I like them. I think they're fun and interesting. I have other things to watch and read.
Totally. But it's intellectual comedy, as I like to call it, even if they talk about balls and such.
Yes.
Anyway, the whole concept is if the taxi service just improve their service and be more of a reasonable rates.
Yeah. And that's when you have a monopoly on something, you don't have to have good service. You don't have, if you're the only business in town, you can charge whatever you want.
Pretty much.
That's kind of the way that taxi services in a lot of countries or cities have. They have a monopoly. Mm-hmm. They only compete with other smaller taxi services, and they make it as difficult as possible to get a battalion to run a taxi. Like, it costs like $10,000, $20,000, $30,000 to even get a medallion or a license to run your own taxi cab. Mm-hmm. But with Uber coming in, they don't have any overhead. They're just people with cars. And so that's how they're disruptive. And it's cool to me, but I understand the other side of, like, that's their business. So I understand they want to protect as well. But speaking of other people disrupting the man in the mainstream, we have YouTube announcing this week, YouTube TV. It combines live content from broadcasting cable television networks with YouTube content. Networks such as ABC, CBS, Fox, and NBC are included, along with local broadcast channels. Unfortunately, you're not going to see content from people like Turner, Viacom, AMC Discovery, or A&E. All those people have other licensing options with other companies. And so they're not included with YouTube TV, unfortunately. You can get them other places, though. So if you have like these other bundle packages, you could probably mix and match. But the product is supposed to be separate from YouTube Red, which is just like their subscription YouTube service. Mm-hmm. But on the other side, YouTube TV already includes YouTube Red. So if you're a big YouTube fan, if you love seeing things on there, especially original content from them, you can get YouTube TV. And it's just, you go to the same place and you just sign in there and you get a bunch of content through that section. It's going to start at $35 a month for up to 6 users. So they give you multiple licenses to use wherever, and it arrives in the spring. So this is definitely a cord cutting option that I think is very interesting. And it's definitely going to cut into, I think, cable packages.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely. It's all a matter about the content, of course, because just like Hulu, just like Netflix, I think it's going to be more of their exclusives that's going to make people want to pay to watch.
Maybe also, that's really what it comes down to for these streaming services. What content do you have? Mm-hmm. And so far, Netflix is hitting on the park with that Marvel stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Hulu is coming to the original content section as well, making original programs, and also catching some of the cable television stuff and live, like, network stuff. Mm-hmm. And it seems like that they're going to be the biggest competitor for YouTube TV. Because as far as, like, just back catalog or original content, Netflix still beats them on this front. So I think YouTube TV's biggest competitor is going to be Hulu, not so much Netflix. So I'm looking forward to seeing what they offer at this point. So, okay. Next story.
Yeah. Twitch will start selling video games this spring. Partnered streamers will get 5% of sales are originating on their channel, with 70% going to the game publisher and the rest to Twitch. Customers who buy games on the Twitch crates with emotes, emote badges, and bits and Twitch currency.
Yeah, so if you're a Twitch player, if you enjoy Twitch, which I think I'm just a little too old for that demographic. I
signed up, but not for me.
It's if you're into watching people play games, Twitch is definitely a place to be. And there are a lot of people who are making a living on Twitch, playing video games, providing entertainment. I mean, you think the most famous one, which is PewDiePie. Yeah. Imagine him getting a 5% cut of all sales for any video game he plays. Like, he can make an extra bit of money. Now, Hans Limu in the chat is asking, so what's the difference between that and YouTube Red? The answer is that YouTube Red, all that content is actually going to be in YouTube TV. But they are separate packages. So if you just want the YouTube stuff, YouTube Red is the way to go. If you also want YouTube Red stuff with cable stuff from like NBC, ABC, and other cable providers, that kind of content, it's kind of the same stuff you would see on Hulu, then you're going to go with YouTube TV, which is kind of the packaging of those items. Stuff. Yeah, but it's also going to be $35. And I think YouTube Red is cheaper than that. I think it's something along the lines of $19-$20 a month. But for the extra $15, I mean, there are a bunch of options for cord cutters. You can go with like Hulu, Netflix. You could also go with things like, what's it called? There are a bunch of like boxes you can provide.
Crates?
No, like little small boxes that provide, that you can get like these channels a la carte.
Oh.
Like okay. Roku. Roku is a good option where you can like just buy individual channels or individual like AMC or just HBO at a much cheaper rate than it would be for a cable package. Potentially, but it kind of depends on what you're looking for and what you already subscribe to.
Yeah.
But again, Twitch is also another live streaming content channel. So at this rate, it makes sense that they would provide, if you're watching these games anyway, click a button here and you can buy it and we'll just get a cut.
Yeah.
So it works for them. It kind of makes sense to me.
Yeah. Cause Twitch, I don't know about you. Like the only time I enjoyed watching somebody else play a video game, if it's a brand new game, if it's something that I've never seen before, let's see what it looks like. you know, get somebody else's take on it. Or if it's like the old video game shows that I used to watch, where it was like showing you the like X Play, showing you the cheats, the codes, well, that kind of bonus feature stuff.
For I think for like X Play, it was a review show, and so the content they would show you were like, oh, these are clips from this game, so you know whether or not to spend $60 on this thing.
Exactly.
Which is not the same. Well, I guess in a way, it sort of is the same thing with Twitch because it's a free service and you get to see the content, but it's also about entertainment. I mean, PewDiePie is not an amazing gamer. He's an entertaining gamer, and for kids and of a people of a certain age category, which I think we're just not that age, it's entertaining to watch someone play a video game and to kind of have the experience of exploring that world from a passive perspective. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah.
So yeah. And so that's a thing, and it's just, it might not make sense to us, but it's the same way that, you know, older generations be like, why are you just sitting inside all day watching television when you can go outside and play? It's like, it's a generational transition of entertainment.
True, because it's pretty much what it was when you were, I don't know how it was when you were little, when you used to play games with your friends.
Yeah.
And it was all about the smack talking and everything while you play a little video game. Yeah. And especially one of like the most famous persons that you literally hear playing is the guy that always yelled out, Leroy Jenkins.
You know, yeah. Just... And do you know where that came from?
No. What was it?
It's a WoW term. It's a WoW character. It's a very famous YouTube video of a guy whose character's name was Leroy Jenkins, and he would run into like these high raid dungeons and basically grab all the aggro from the monsters and kind of wipe the party. Because the rest of the party would be stupid, and they would all follow him because like, oh, he's dying. No, he's not Jaleek. He's like, oh, your inclination when your party member starts a fight is like, oh, you help them out. Mm-hmm. Like that's the whole point of a raid of a dungeon group, and so he would intentionally run into these dungeons and start the boss fight before everybody was ready and just kind of be that guy, and then the rest of the party would be like, I guess we're starting this, and they would all run, and the party would inevitably wipe, and it was just this big thing, and it became this internet sensation and meme of like, okay, that we all know that dude who does that sometimes guy. And now we have a name for him, Leroy Jenkins.
I used to be just the guy that just, you know, while we were playing next to somebody, kind of like slapped their hand in the controller.
Yes, kind and of that can actually do the. We'll talk about this a little later, but we just got the, as in we, I mean, we got the Nintendo Switch, and one of the games for the Nintendo Switch 1, 2, 3 is that actually does that. Like it's intentional. Like the game is that one person has one half of the controller, the other person has the other half of the controller, and you're spinning in plates, and you can win by knocking your opponent out and like making them like lose their plate basically. And so that's one of the, you know, the social aspects that I think is coming back for video games, especially like for the Nintendo systems, that with the Wii or with the Nintendo Switch, that aspect of like having live interactions instead of just like streaming or playing with people across the internet, which is cool still. It's just not, you know, there's a different level of enjoyment when you're in the same room with somebody playing a game.
Oh yeah, other than the at the time, it was, you could do a lot of smack talking. I mean, you could literally talk horrible stuff, but now they got actually filters, filters and stuff like that.
Because it becomes a hassle.
It happened to a friend of mine. I could tell you that her experience. He was playing some kid, literally. This guy, my friend, same age as me, 30-something-year-old guy, playing some probably 12-year-old punk, whatever, to start talking smack. So he starts talking smack back, and I guess he hit a nerve. And, and the little kid was like complaining, and my friend actually got a letter... from Xbox saying that we're not going to ban you, but this is a warning. Yeah, warning that, you know, you can't say that kind of stuff.
Or it's even worse is when they swat each other. Like, they'll report, they'll find out their address, and they'll report, like, there's a drug den there, or like,
you're a pedophile.
I heard somebody, like, threatening somebody, I'm a hero, come save me, and then the police show up at your house, they break in the door while you're playing the game.
Oh, yeah.
And the other person's just laughing their butt off because they're playing with you at the same time over the internet, and they hear you doing it that way. So I'm like, there you go. Quick shout out to Dorian Alvarez.
Hey, Dorian.
Hey, Dorian.
The other kind of relating to this thing is this quick story, is the international prank calling.
Yes.
People will call from Australia or to Australia.
That seems so expensive, man.
But if it's that funny, and they would find it... With technology now, you could Google Map anybody's address and location.
Yeah,
whatever.
ISP, VoIP it. Yeah.
Exactly. And they would crank call cops, crank call whatever kind of things, you know. Yep. Just,
and that's no, technically, there's nothing against law there. Different countries, different rules. That's the way it goes. Okay. Moving on to some other gaming news. We have some great information from Microsoft. Microsoft has announced Game Pass, which is a $10 a month subscription service that lets users play any of more than 100 Xbox One games and Xbox 360 games over the internet. The games are going to change from time to time, but at launch, it's going to include games like Halo 5, Guardians, Payday 2, NBA 2K16, and Soul Calibur 2. Games download to the console, and you'll have to option to buy them at a discount. So it very much is like a digital subscription service. Xbox Insider Preview members will get first crack, followed by Xbox Live Gold members, and then the full launch is going to be coming this spring. So lots of stuff popping up in the spring. But this seems like this definitely feels like a Netflix option for video games.
Yeah, compared to a long time ago, this is me going back in the day.
Although PlayStation does this too, I think.
PlayStation has something available like that, but a long time ago, the first one to semi do it was Sega. Sega had an old school dial up version of the same thing, plug it into the back, pick your game and all that stuff. But the concept is cool because it's almost like Gamefly, but without having to wait for the disc.
Yes, and not like I say, but just like the way that Netflix changed from DVD deliveries by in the mail to just sending you the stuff. Xbox very much is figuring out, this is an option. Let them download it and just include coding that makes it disappear or unplayable if they stop their subscription service.
Yeah, and I myself am an Xbox. I got an Xbox One.
Yep.
I've actually partaked on it.
Have you tried the service or like their download streaming
just
service?
Just the download. And it's fun. It's the legit gaming and everything. They know what they're doing, so they code it a certain way.
Only downside I would think is hard drive space.
That's the only plus/minus. Don't get me wrong. You get advantage of the awesome 2-3 games a month from Xbox, and total up to you. If you want to keep it, if you don't want whatever, unless you want to just go ahead and invest in a new hard drive,
which is an option with Xbox. It's easier on Xbox, and it just became easier on the PlayStation 4 with their latest system update.
Yeah,
we can just plug in a hard drive and there you go, you have more space. Moving on to some more gaming news, we have some great announcements from the Game Developers Choice Awards. These are the big fancy game awards, and there's some surprising winners to me. That's you.
I'm reading it right now. Let's see. At the Game Developers Choice Awards Wednesday, Blizzard's Overwatch received awards for Best Game and Best Design. Campo Santo's game Firewatch took home Best Narrative and Best Debut. Playdead's Inside took Best Audio and Best Visual Art. Pokemon Go won Best Mobile Game. Job Simulator, the 2050 Archives won Best VR/AR game. No Man's Sky surprised its own creators by winning the Best Innovation Award.
Yeah, so a lot of very interesting titles. I've played some of these personally, but I haven't played all of them. I've never played Overwatch. I'm surprised it got so many awards. I mean, best in game, best in design.
It was good.
The gamer friends that I know are like, "Oh, Overwatch is for casuals." I'm like, I guess. I'm not really into competitive shooters.
It must be just a lot of casuals.
I've heard Firewatch, it has a really good story. It's a game that takes place in a first-person perspective in like this cel-shaded world. And it's like this mystery thriller kind of thing.
Yeah.
And I haven't played it, but I heard it's really good. I played Pokemon Go. It's no surprise that it won Best Mobile Game, and it's only going to get better. Apparently, they're going to start implementing trading in the next couple months where players can trade if they're in the same physical vicinity. So, like, other players that you see on the map, you can, like, meet up with them and trade that way. They're not going to trade a lot of, like, worldwide crossing trading, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But I'm sure someone's going to be able to spoof their phone and be like, oh, where are you at? Where's your coordinates? Oh, here we go. Bam. Oh, I'm next to you now. Now we can trade.
Yeah.
Or something like that.
So in the meantime, it's going to be like a creepy Craigslist meetup.
I think it might be.
Yeah.
I mean, so I can see like listings popping up saying, looking for, whatever.
For a blowjob or a coffee table kind of thing.
In exchange for a Pikachu.
Yeah.
I can see that happening. Yeah, absolutely. Those interesting Craigslist ads. But some other ones, I'm surprised No Man's Sky got an award. It's a very pretty game. So, and it's very innovative. So I guess I get that. But everything else is like, oh, that's cool. I haven't played those, though.
Yeah.
So, there we go.
Nothing that I personally watch, but... Or play, should I say. The whole job simulator, though. I was like, I just it's don't know best, what kind of job
you're best doing. VR AR game. So among the virtual reality, augmented reality games, that one is probably the most entertaining because it's accurate enough to do a thing, whether it's, you know, grocery clerk guy or something.
Yeah, I was going
to
say, might as well be Clerks the game. Yeah. So you yourself play Dante behind the counter. I think that
would be an amazing VR game. Like, you're either in a Moo Hat or behind the counter of Clerks, and you just deal with customers. And you Randall just, you get dialogue options that you get to choose. And you just go along with the narrative. Well, I think that would be highly entertaining.
That was one game that was supposed to be in development that hasn't been official. The Jane Silent Bob's Chronic Blunt Punch.
That was the action game, right?
Yeah, it was like
a... Did that ever come out?
No.
I don't remember.
Supposedly the guy that played Elias in Clerks 2 is actually a game developer.
Yeah, no, he's... I saw that on... There's a... I went at a Kickstarter, but podcast. It was
Kickstarter-ish kind of thing.
It was a different program from Kickstarter where you actually can invest in the game program and become an investor. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that ever came out, but they had actual, like... graphics and videos mm-hmm. of it. They still might be making, but I don't know if it ever came out though.
Hopefully it does. I think they were just working on some of the legalities. I would think it'd get some more of the BSQ universe
characters. I mean, because those are the only characters he owns though. He only owns Jay and Silent Bob. He doesn't own any of the other characters, so he can't add them into whatever he wants to. But at least he can make the Jay and Silent Bob, what is it called? Remake? Redo?
The reboot.
That's what it's called. The new Kevin Smith film that he's writing currently is Jay and Silent Bob Reboot, which is still Jay and Silent Bob, but they're going to make fun of reboot movies.
Yeah.
So I like that. Hans Lehman the Sharkman says, that job simulator was funny. Simulate being a porn star. Lol.
Hey, man, they got adaptions. You get add some fleshlight on there?
Oh, like some added attachments of vibrators?
Yeah, why not? Yeah, dude.
Yeah, I don't doubt that actually already exists.
Or if it's a pegging, you know.
Yeah, that stuff for virtual reality actually already exists. It's just not really mainstream, and it's not... I don't think it's... too cool. They actually have one. This is from Japan, obviously. Mm-hmm. Makes sense. Where you are an augmented or virtual reality game, and you have to take pictures of girls' skirts underneath. But like, there's an actual physical thing there that you can touch and kind of move around with. And it's totally Japan. So those are the things that virtual reality is being made mainstream. Just like the DVD wars were won by porn.
Oh, yeah.
Same thing, I think, with virtual reality. That's going to be the industry that's willing to take the risks in developing innovative, interesting things, because that's what drives humanity, apparently. Hey, why not?
As long as you don't get no virtual cum in your hair, I think everything's all right.
That's what everyone says. Like, you missed the jizz in your hair.
Yeah, exactly.
So there you go. Hans Zimu in the chat mass. Why do you guys know about that fleshlight, Edgar?
I'll be honest, I'm into porn. I know about fleshlights. I know about little anal beads, ring pieces, and stuff like that. I'm open about it. I talk about porn. Yeah, about it. I'm totally comfortable with it.
I listen to Kevin Smith podcasts galore, so that's how I know about it.
Honestly, even one of those times where I was single and I wasn't going out and, you know, whatever, I'm like, hell,
it's
I'd cop up some money. And
cheaper than a hooker.
Oh, safer, cleaner. There you go. There ain't no shame with no fleshlight.
Just make
man.
Sure you wash it out afterwards. I think that was Kevin Smith's thing. He forgot. He didn't realize you had to wash it out every time. So it got a little crunchy in there after a while.
Yeah, cum dries. It becomes very crunchy. Apparently. And the other part about it, too, is one time he forgot and left it like laying down. So the cum was actually dripping out of the fleshlight. And actually a whole line of ants came up and started pretty much eating the cum.
Eating the protein.
Yeah. There you go. So, yeah, man. Keep it legit. I like the people on Front Street instead of being like, oh, what are you talking about? I don't do that.
Too
kind of
legit,
stuff.
Man. Too legit.
There's no taboo, man. I put it all on
Nothing Front is Street. Safe from this podcast. Absolutely not.
Put it on.
Okay. Moving on to some entertainment stuff from the internets. We have the X-Men universe. They're making an X-Men television show that's legit. Like, they're going to use the X-Men name. And apparently, Bryan Singer is going to direct the pilot, but not the entire series. They're trying to attach a big director name to it so it gets picked up. So we like the fact that
get one that wasn't accused of pedophilia / casting couch.
They like the big name director who's associated with X-Men. So it makes sense.
That guy.
But we have a couple names who were cast in the show. Amy Akers, might know her better from the Joss Whedonverse. Fred Buerkle, or on Dollhouse, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., and Much Ado About Nothing. She's going to be the female lead in the show. And there's also Stephen Moyer from True Blood as Bill Compton. He's the male lead in the X-Men television show. And if you don't remember what that show is supposed to be about, it's supposed to be about parents who have mutant kids who are just, their powers are just expressing themselves and they don't know how to deal with it. That's like the base rumor script about it anyway. Like they haven't started filming anything yet, so it might switch. We never know. That often happens. But that's the base storyline.
Yeah, because the only thing, well, other than what's happening right now is Legion is the only kind of X-Men related thing on
television. And it's really good. I love every episode. Every episode is really cool, unique, and it's very much like a Discovery show. Mm-hmm. And it's very psychological because that's part of the uniqueness of that character, which I'm really loving.
Yeah, and the only other show slash it was a TV movie a long time ago Fox actually put out was Generation X. They actually had Jubilee, White Queen, Banshee. It actually took place at the X-Men mansion
and everything. And it sucked.
It was bad.
Sorry.
But hopefully they could, you know, they learn from it. They learn from all the millions of dollars they made from those X-Men.
Well, yeah, because they kind of want some of that DC, the DC CW universe.
Yeah.
Where that they're making money hand over fist with those properties. And also some of that Marvel Netflix television stuff. Like, oh, they're making money. Why can't we? We have that X-Men license, right, Fox?
Yeah, just and get so rid of Bryan Singer.
Yeah, but Hans in the chat room now says, he's not a big fan of Bryan Singer either.
Hated it. Don't get me wrong. When the first X-Men movie came out, I'm like, hell yeah, somebody's doing it, Bryan Singer. Oh my God, it's probably going to be amazing. Blah, blah, blah. I saw it. I was like, what the fuck? I was like, seriously?
I didn't mind. I got to say.
I think we disagree
on this particular subject. Yeah. I don't really care as long as it's a good movie.
Yeah, true, but I think I don't know. Instead of me pointing fingers and wanting death upon Bryan Singer, because he's just a director. Yes. He's not the writer, so the script isn't right, really his. Unless he got involved in a script, which is a whole different story.
Well, but you got to remember that those movies were part of the time frame. Like superhero movies didn't exist.
Oh, they exist.
Not in the way they do now, but they were very much like, oh, we can't be superheroes. We can't be comic book superheroes.
Oh,
We don't want to be Batman 3. You know what I mean? We want to be popular. So they try to modernize them and make them more realistic. And that's what came out of that particular time frame. And then later on, as they saw, oh, there's money here, we can be creative. And that creativity was not penalized by ticket sales. You know? So that, I mean, just kind of what it is.
I know they try to go to a more like realistic, nitty gritty kind of thing. Don't expect.
And of course, they've gone away from that, though.
Yeah, it's not like the joke in X-Men. Like, what do you expect to wear? Yellow spandex kind of deal.
Yeah,
but
in that first movie, yeah,
it just totally could have been better. But you know that happened. It happened. We all live with it, man.
We all have to deal with our traumas.
Yeah.
Okay.
Fuck Singer, by the way.
So. Moving on to the Inhumans casting, though.
All right. Filming of Inhumans, the TV series, has begun this week, and we now have the rest of the royal family of... Atlan, for the new series. Anson Mount from Hell on Wheels will be Black Bolt. Iwan Rian from Game of Thrones as Maximus the Mad. Serinda Swan from Smallville will be Medusa. Yu Ikwakor, Isabella Cornish, Mike Moe, and Sonya Balmers are playing Gorgon, Crystal, Triton, and Auron, respectively. Gorgon and Triton are cousins to the Inhumans royal family. Gorgon has a powerful strength and semisonic hooves. Triton has the ability to live and breathe underwater. Crystal is King Black Bolt and Queen Medusa's daughter and rightful heir to the throne of Atlantean or Atalian. Somebody will correct me on that. Her power is the ability to control the elements. Auron is not directly related to the royal family, but is as fiercely loyal as their head bodyguard. Apart to their unique cat-like physical features, she has keen super hearing.
Yeah, so. And Han says Serinda Swan is fine as hell. That's going to be this lady, I think, right? The redhead.
Okay.
I don't remember her from Smallville, honestly. So that was her claim to fame.
Yeah, but My thing is with Crystal. Crystal was always a weird character, at least design-wise, because she has this weird, like, even in the cartoons, it kind of still didn't make sense. She has this weird, like, pattern where it's, like, black bar almost going across. It almost looks like the Pokeball symbol that's on her hair. So, I don't know, like, even in the comic books, I never understood it. I don't know if it was a pattern thing, if, like, a headband thing or what it was, but it was just weird to me. But I like to see the concept, how they're going to play this out, especially Black Bolt. Don't get me wrong. He looks more like Jason Momoa or whatever, the Aquaman dude, because of the long hair and the beard. So, especially how, once again, Marvel does the whole modernizing of it. We'll see. Oh, there you go.
Oh, Zatanna. Okay. Yeah, Hunter. She was Zatanna in Ms. Marvel. Okay. So, that's why I don't recognize. She wasn't there as a long-term cast member, I think.
Yeah, because I don't know if these guys are going to actually wear, like, especially Black Bolt, the bodysuit kind of thing. As for Triton,
I don't see why not. I mean, it's kind of acceptable now to wear your costumes in the DC universe, at least.
Marvel. But this is Marvel. Well, I know. They like to twitch it out. Because, like, one great example is, like, Bullseye with Colin Farrell, instead of wearing the mask kind of thing.
Don't, they did that don't talk about that movie.
That scarification Bullseye kind
of thing. But Daredevil was still in his costume. I mean, you can't say that they are not, that they're costume shy at this point. I mean, they don't have to, obviously, but I would think it'd be okay.
It's their personal preference of having more of the open face exposed.
Well, yeah, if you're paying for that actor face, you want to show it off.
Yeah, that's true.
So there you go. Okay, so those are the castings for The Inhumans, which is actually filming. So I'm happy to see another superhero film, if nothing else. Now moving on to Sylvester Stallone. Apparently he's going to be in Guardians of the Galaxy 2. This was spotted by some very
keen eyes
looking at the movie poster. Apparently his name is in the movie poster credits. Nobody's said what he's doing yet. It's very hush-hush. I know they're almost done with the filming for Guardians 2. I don't know if they're going to do reshooting or not. But he's apparently in the film. We don't know what he does, but he's in that movie. So there you go.
I was wondering, especially going back to... I'm sorry, real quick. I still want to talk a little quick about Inhumans. I want to hear more about, like... I don't know if you know who Lockjaw is. You know who Lockjaw is?
Nope.
Oh. It's going to be this, like, big bulldog-ish kind of creature that has the, like, ability to teleport.
Yeah.
So I wonder
how they're going to work. I know who he is. I don't know, like, who's playing him, though.
Oh, okay. Well, that, and also I was thinking, like, for the Black Bolt character, which is going to be amazing for that actor, because guess what? He's going to get paid to not say a thing.
Yes.
So
they're going to do the telepathing for his voice, I believe.
Oh, okay. Well, voiceover thing, but he's still just going to be like,
Yeah, no, Vin Diesel was, I think, very disappointed that he didn't get that, because he was originally attached for that as, I believe, a movie role for The Inhumans. Yeah. When it was going to be a movie and not a television, he was supposed to be Black Bolt.
I can see it. He has the look.
Yeah, and he's okay with doing voiceover work, obviously.
Yeah.
And with his Groot experience.
And Iron Giant.
Yeah, so.
Yeah. Okay. Now, but to Sylvester Stallone.
That was it. It was just an announcement. I don't think anybody really cares.
I think he'll be kind of like, well, Benicio del Toro had more of a scene. Yeah, he was actually.
He was a character. Yeah, he was a major like plot character.
Yeah, I don't expect Sylvester Stallone to be Adam Warlock or anything like that. But I don't know. Who do you think he could be in the universe?
That's just it. That comic series is just not as well known. So he could be anybody, and they can try to stick him in, and as just like a little cameo, or even like a character like Benicio del Toro, as like a not super popular character, but super fun to play, maybe. And then Sylvester Stallone is now in, you know, the Marvel, you know, cinematic universe.
Yeah. Especially if you're going to put his name on there on your poster.
Just be contracts. So, like, he's a big name, so put him on the poster.
That's true. Well, if anything, you know, at least because I would love to hear his impersonation or his version of him playing Howard the Duck.
That would be super funny if he was just the voice of Howard the Duck.
Sylvester Stallone as Howard the Duck would have been amazing. Speaking of, I saw this video of him. Dude is 70 years old, and he is in ridiculous
shape. No, he keeps in shape for those Incredibles movies. Man. Yeah.
Nobody's forcing him, dude, just put the weights down. Just be mellow. Be cool.
No, that's part of his. That's him. Yeah, if I had money and trainers, why not?
Man, he's married, right?
I don't know.
I'm all like, man.
Are you asking for like a certain somebody, you know?
Well, kind of, man. If you're like, don't get me wrong, you must have the most incredible woman in your life to.
I know he has a couple of kids. Yeah, he has a couple of kids, but I don't know if he has a wife.
Yeah, to keep looking hot for your lady and everything. But, you know, once you're married, you're probably just like, fuck it, whatever, I'm done. But if you're
just ask the two married guys here.
Yeah, yeah. Unless you're, you still want to, you know, get some chicks and stuff, even at 70, dude. Oh, man.
No, he's ripped, yeah.
I don't expect him to pop the blue pill.
Well, I think most of the guys who are like the action star generation have kept their shape, really, if nothing,
good
than
ones.
The professional roles. I mean, you think of, oh, God, what's his name? You think of He-Man. And he was Duff Lundgren, yeah. He stayed in shape. Sylvester Stallone did.
Yep. Like the good.
Also
good.
Arnold Schwarzenegger. They all stayed in shape because they realized that their success depends upon their physical appearance. And so that was always a big part of their...
Unless you're fucking Val Kilmer. It's fat ass.
Yeah. No, but he was never an action star. He was never like that muscle-bound action star. He was always like, just a good-looking dude. Not even then.
He played some other heroes.
Yeah, I mean, but still, he was never the action guy. He was always like, just the good-looking dude ladies wanted to sleep with.
Yeah, don't get me wrong. I'm you know, I got some LBSs on me, and this is just me being a dude.
And Hans is informing us that Sylvester Stallone is married, and he has 3 fine-ass daughters. Those are his words.
I think because he doesn't have a son. Oh, no, he has a son. No, he has a brother.
I don't know.
Yeah, he has a brother for sure.
Does he have a half brother who does his voiceover work? Like,
oh no, kind of looks
like Tom Hanks does. Yeah, Tom Hanks has a brother. He does all the voices for all the toys for Toy Story. His brother does the voices.
Oh really?
Yeah, yeah.
Wow, that's new to me. Because I never heard of that.
I'm like, why not kick your brother some work if he sounds like you? Who's willing to listen to the toy? Paid. Yeah.
Oh, he did. I think that was the.
Yeah. Oh, good job, Edgar. Yeah. Right. Mm. Moving on to
change of tone. Yeah.
The next story was definitely more entertaining for me than Sylvester Stallone in Guardians of the Galaxy 2.
Yeah.
The rumors around a Green Lantern Corps member appearing in the Justice League. Rumors were speculating about who it's going to be because we know there's going to be a standalone Green Lantern Corps film, but we weren't sure who's going to do a guest appearance. And apparently, rumor is that it's going to be Abin Sur, not Hal Jordan, not any of the Earth Green Lanterns, but Abin Sur. So that's, I'm like, oh, that's cool. I'm happy to see that they're going to actually have a Green Lantern member in the Justice League movies because it's a Justice.
Yeah.
He's always been a member of the Justice League.
Yeah, because everybody wanted to see Green Lantern. Yeah. It doesn't matter if it was Hal Jordan. Doesn't matter if it was, what's the other one? The has the same name as the guy from The Daily Show.
John Stewart?
There you go.
You mean the Black Green Lantern?
The Black. Well, I didn't want to go that route.
That guy. Oh, fine.
I'm a racial sensitive kind of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He stands out, though. I mean, he's kind of an important, iconic figure for an entire group of like young Black men who grew up. They're like, he looks like me, but he's a superhero. So great. And he's not called Black something.
The token Black guy.
Yeah, but he's also not called like, the Black Panther or the Black Lightning or, you know, like, he was just the Green Lantern.
Black.
Yeah, he's the Green Lantern.
Yeah. So. But, I want to see how it is. Hopefully they don't go the route of that Green Lantern movie and give him an animated suit.
I don't even care. I think he's just a cameo.
But,
I don't care. I mean, if he's going to be an alien and he's going to have a, you know, CG face, why not do the CG suit? I think the bigger issue in that movie was that not so much that the suit was animated. It was that the story kind of sucked.
Yeah.
And it wasn't the Green Lantern that we were expecting.
Yeah. If you're going to have a cameo of a Green Lantern Corp member, be that one squirrel. I want to see that one Green Lantern squirrel.
I wouldn't mind doing the voiceover for the squirrel now.
That would be amazing. More entertaining.
Yeah, or Kilowog. That's always a fun character.
Kilowog is all right. Yeah, he's cool.
Okay. But that's some entertainment news. We also have some interesting rumors. Some Jedi Star Wars rumors.
Yeah.
That's going to be the last Star Wars rumors deal with a possible upcoming plot of The Last Jedi. Apparently, again, if you don't want spoilers, just pause the volume, I guess, for the next minute or so. We'll, like, signal that we're done. But the rumors about the script are basically that the blow struck against the New Republic, which is being destroyed, basically, by the First Order. Apparently, Snoke and Leia are both scrambling to find allies to support their goals. So that's, like, the big plot for Leia. And for the bad guy, Snoke. Also, the secondary storyline is going to focus on Rey being trained by Luke Skywalker so that they're going to be the last Jedi. Apparently, Jedi is also plural for Jedi. So they're going to be the last two Jedi.
Multiple.
Yeah, multiple Jedis. They're still the ending line, though. So it is also rumored that those two storylines are going to converge the same way that they did in The Empire Strikes Back. Yep. And so that those are the rumors. So you can, if you're watching this and you turn the volume off, we're back. So there you go. And so what do you think of that particular plot line? Do you think it's a little too familiar, or do you think...
Well, that was the whole debate, because especially with Carrie Fisher dying, yes. Obviously, they say they filmed her
But that scenes, doesn't affect thankfully. Number two.
Either way.
I mean, unless they're going to kill her off in two, so she don't have to worry about number three.
Exactly, unless, knock on wood, Mr. Mark Hamill better be in great shape, too, because you don't want them...
They had a life insurance policy on her, though. I thought that was interesting, and very, I mean, they're all older.
Oh, yeah, actually, acts of God, it happens.
Yeah, and Hans Limu says, rip. Oh, rest in peace.
For Sage.
That's, yes. That's Sage.
Stop bringing back all the sad stuff.
You know, whomever. That rip can be for multiple peoples.
Yeah. Like Rip Taylor. But I just want to see the movie. Just want to see the movie. Like, don't get me wrong. It could be a horrible storyline or anything. People are going to pay to go
watch it. You're still going to watch it. Okay.
People are going to pay to go watch it. Yeah.
If that's, hey, there you go. That's kind of the final thought for both of us. We don't really care what it's about. We're going to watch it anyways. Exactly. They have our money. They just have to make the movie.
Exactly.
Okay. There you go.
No, oh, sorry. Now, one that I'm happy, personally, after debating whether or not to move forward with Tron 3, Disney is gearing up for a third movie in the franchise. Yay. The Hollywood Reporter confirmed this week that the studio is in early stages of working on a version of the third installment, but will not be a direct sequel. Instead, the movie will be based on a concept of the film's earlier script, according to the reporter. Suicide Squad star Jared Leto is being eyed for the main role.
Yep, there you go.
I'm happy that it's being made, because honestly, I like Tron.
I like the original Tron.
Legacy? I liked Legacy.
It was okay. It wasn't like amazing to me. It's never going to have the same nostalgia effect as that original Tron, because it was set up in a world where PC gaming wasn't as popularized. And so it felt very fan-oriented.
Yeah.
You know, and it felt very like inside jokey with, you know, jokes about ROM and RAM and, you know, the hard drive and that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And in the digital age, that just doesn't translate well to our modern age of tablets and VR and, you know, that kind of stuff.
I loved it. I loved the whole look of it. Everything was amazing to me. Hell, I forgot which one. I think it's Shanghai Disney has a whole Tron ride based off of it. There you go. It looks amazing. The whole look of it. I love the characters. I loved everything about it. Even in the original, when it was like all about glow sticks and hockey helmets, It was what it was for its time, and it just showed how amazing what a possible futuristic world could be via, I guess, not exactly like the old
digital teleportation.
Kind of, it's not exactly like the old CG reboot.
Yeah.
Show, you ever watched that?
I've seen
with
it.
The glitch thing and all. No,
yeah, like I said, the original definitely has that aspect of living in a computer system, which is very much popular fiction. I just don't think two added anything of extra value to it. And that's just my opinion. Maybe I'm the minority. It obviously made enough money for them to make Tron 3. Mm-hmm. I just don't think they added enough new cool things that translate to our modern age.
Well,
that's all I'm saying.
That's why, especially did you watch Legacy?
Yeah, I saw Legacy.
Especially towards the end, it almost became like a almost Matrix ish style, because the programs got transformed to real life. So now I think it's going to be a whole virtual characters versus real world characters in the real world, you know. So I don't know if you'll see the actual, like, even though they made it in real life, you'll see the actual Tron bikes on the streets.
I agree with Hans Lee Moon. Hans in the chat room is not saying, since they're doing remakes, they should do a remake of The Last Starfighter.
That was one that's been talked classic. About a lot. And the whole concept is funny. Is that the arcade one?
That's the one where the arcade machine is a training simulator? It's a test for star pilot recruits. And so eventually, both the bad guys, I mean, the villains in that movie were weird looking. And the special effects were totally cheesy, but they were steady though at the time. But it definitely has that same kind of vibe of like, video game, star fiction, science fiction kind of thing going on.
Oh, yeah.
And so that's why it appealed to a lot of people. And this, in part, kind of leads into the other podcast I do, which is the Lit RPG podcast that incorporates all that video game stuff within fiction, science fiction, fantasy. And so it kind of combines the same kind of concepts that The Last Starfighter did and that Tron did, and that those role-playing game elements and those video game elements tie into are actually stated in the actual story. So they'll say things like level up or like getting gold or experience points. Mm-hmm. And even in a fiction setting where it's like, oh, you're getting a blaster skill instead of a sword skill, it kind of applies. And I think that they just kind of speak to the kind of culture combining video games, science fiction, fantasy, movies, all that great stuff. And I think The Last Starfighter is definitely a big part of that. And that's why it's appealing. So I can see a remake being done and doing really well if they do it correctly. The same way that I feel about like Ready Player One, going from, you know, the book to the mm-hmm. movie screen. That to me is also Lit RPG. And so I hope that they keep all the cool game stuff and they don't just get rid of it because of licensing issues.
Any other old school like sci-fi movie that you'd like to see kind of give a reboot?
I can't remember that. It was the one with I forget, something Quaid, where Me and You or Us or something, where he was like stranded on an alien planet mm-hmm. with an alien looking lizard dude.
Oh, that wound up being semi male but gave birth.
Yeah, that one. Yeah, I forget what that's called.
I know which movie you're talking about. But it was like called
Us or something. Yeah. And I thought that was a really cool science fiction film as well. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't mind seeing that redone, especially as like, oh, it's different cultures intermingling.
I just wondered how like it got pregnant unless the alien and the dude got it on.
No, I think awesome. he was already had eggs inside of him. And so it's just like, I think the part of that was like different species procreate differently, whether it's mm-hmm. he's impregnated himself or the eggs are already self-fertilized from an earlier occasion and they mm-hmm. that egg just happened to start its gestation period because of the high stress environment. Mm-hmm. Something like that. That's it. Yep. Hans know what it's called. It's called Enemy Mine.
Yeah.
Solar babies.
I don't remember Solar Babies.
No, I think he's referring to the kid and the alien dude. Yeah.
But I don't know how well it would do. Obviously they got great writers to
it kind of always depends on the script like anything else.
I was gonna say Disney's the black hole was pretty boring to be honest, but it had some really cool elements with especially
so that just feels like a porn robots. Title that feels like a porn title name, like this is not your black hole XXX. But no, it's another sci-fi film that came out at the same time as like a Space Odyssey. Mm-hmm. And that kind of vibe to it, whereas very modern. It was definitely the same type of stylization as well. But you're right. Yeah, I don't think it did as well as like some of the other sci-fi stuff.
Or one that especially how they've now evolved with especially CG technology is I think it's was it 20,000 Leagues
Under the Sea. Yeah, they redid that.
Have they done that?
Well, they sort of redid it. I remember they redid it with A League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
Oh, that's true.
They kind of redid it there where it was Captain Nemo was an Indian guy.
Yeah, that's true. And I liked it.
Yeah, I like that movie a lot too. Yeah, yeah.
That was another I wish they made a sequel to.
Well, I don't know if sequel. Yes, not redo.
No, not redo. Yeah, sequel.
Everyone's still alive in that one.
Yeah, yeah. Old, but
okay. Hey, look, Heidi's watching.
Hi, Heidi.
Hey, Heidi. Okay, on to our review of the Nintendo Switch. This is like the big highlight of the show.
Bust it out, man!
It's also a tax write-off apparently for the show. Hey. So I'm like, hey. Double bonus. Solar Babies was a movie back in the 80s, according to Hans Limu. I had absolutely no idea that was actually a thing. I thought he was just really talking familiar. About it. Yeah.
So
look, Heidi gave us a nice little happy face. Hey, what's up? Look what we got here.
So there it is, man. The legit Switch.
Yeah, this is the mobile version of it. Of course, it plugs into the dock, and you know it goes on your big television. So
it is a touchscreen.
Yeah, there's a totally touchscreen.
Okay, I thought it was the whole concept was using the joysticks on the side.
No, you can.
But anyway, looks cool. As you can see, the scale, how small it is. It's very light. So far, I don't know how long he's played it record-wise, but he haven't had a heating issue because we just noticed there's actually a vent up on top.
Yeah.
So it has its own little cooling system.
Yeah, and the transition between like the big screen and the small screen is actually like
seamless.
Yeah, yeah. No, absolutely was seamless. You just plug it in, plop it out, and it goes from handheld to big screen with no hiccups. You don't have to reload or anything. And especially with this particular game, Zelda The Wind Waker, there's no load screens besides the initial one. Like, you can go anywhere in the world, and as long as you can get there and figure out a way to do it, it's totally still the same. I'll admit, I have limited experience with this particular console, so I just have the one game of Zelda, the Breath of the Wild. Yeah. But it's a great game. I'm enjoying it immensely.
Yeah, they have a crazy like launch title of Mono games.
But... What I thought was really interesting, though, was how small this thing is. Like, this is literally the entire console. Like, this is it. Like, you plug it into a dock to send the information to the big screen television.
Or, like, a charging station.
But this is it. I mean, this is the same system that plays it on here. Is the same one that plays it on the big one, on the big television. And it's smaller than the Wii U. I'm like, they really compacted all this cool game stuff into this.
Are these little thingies a button? Not the tab, but this thing?
No, that's the thing that that's the thing that lets it go out. Like, you press it and it unlocks it. Yeah, it's the release.
Oh, okay. Once again, still new system, so...
Yeah, but a lot of this is really cool. It's a lot smaller. It doesn't come with the game, so if you go purchase it, you're just buying that system for $300, and you have to buy a game separately, any extra controller. So it ends up being like a $400 or $500 investment at minimum. So it's not really $300. It's $300 plus whatever you're going to play for at least one game. Additionally, apparently the cartridges are super tiny. Like, this thing is, like, really...
Bust it out, turn it off.
Yeah. Well,
is it safe to unmount it? Do you have to unmount or any of that
kind of stuff? No, it's really simple to turn off. Like, I can put it into sleep mode real quick. Yeah. But, yeah, like, the cartridges are super tiny.
They are, like, like you talked about the Galaxy. There are some Galaxies that do have little mount thingies that you could actually do it for your
Here's the game cartridge, folks.
And you can see it's modified. It's not identical. It looks obviously patent-pended and all that.
So it's an actual cartridge. Mm-hmm. It kind of looks the Galaxy with joysticks on both ends, according to Hans. Yeah, it very much reminds me of like the PS Vita look, but the joysticks on the side come off. Like, you can hit a switch and take them off and put it in like this little kickstand mode where you can play it with this joysticks in your hands.
Is this a game?
Oh, yeah. And apparently there's, I don't know if you heard the story. Apparently Nintendo intentionally coated their games, cartridges, with like this weird, funky taste thing that makes it taste horrible. It's non-toxic, but they wanted to stop kids and pets from accidentally ingesting it. So if you want to lick it, man, you tell me what it tastes like.
Oh, it actually does.
What does it taste like? So look at
bitter. It's actually bitter tasting. It's, you ever seen or heard of that little, like, iodine, whatever kind of thing that you put on babies' fingers to prevent them from licking their fingers or biting their nails or whatever?
Nope. We just use chili powder in my family.
Not spicy. So
yeah, so you...
I wouldn't recommend
eating it. Press a little bun in the back.
But like, oh, my God. And it gets worse. It gets worse when you do it again. I'm not going to go for a third time, but... Yeah,
and so these controllers come off. So these controllers come off, and you can use them like you would with the Wii, like special like movement games. For I think the one title that uses them currently is the 1-2-3 Switch. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so that's how they work, guys.
This is definitely a punishment for kids and animals. Oh my God!
You didn't clean your room. Go lick the Nintendo cartridge.
Lick it. Can I imagine what flavor you would get if you put it in your butt?
Yeah, no, but they intentionally make it not taste good, apparently. So I'm like, okay, I get that. Because they're so tiny, though. Like, you could easily swallow them.
Yeah, that's true. Because, you know, it's one of those small pieces not intended for children under 3.
Hans' advice in the chat room is, we'll stop licking it.
I'm the dumb guy that I'm going to do. I'm the kid that, they got the 9-volt battery and used to do the thing on the tongue just because, you know, it's a dumb thing to do.
And that's why his hair turned white when he was in his 20s.
True. And that's how I developed... taste. Hopefully I didn't kill any taste buds while doing that, but
no, we'll find out a little bit when we make that beef stroganoff after the podcast something.
Yeah, but it's fun. I'm actually very tempted to get one for myself, because that's the thing with mobile gaming, not just like the phones yourself.
This is a real console. This is like really fun and interesting, and the gameplay experience is definitely like a regular handheld mobile phone. Intended. Yeah. it's definitely a better experience than a mobile phone.
Yeah, because I feel like that's going to replace...
Yeah, and this kind of explains why Nintendo has not been as invested in mobile gaming, because they still want you to play their mobile devices, especially when their mobile device is also their console. So I can definitely see other mobile titles like... what's that thing called? The Mario games, of course. Mm-hmm. all that coming out for the handheld, which is also going to be the console. But there's also apparently a bunch of digital stuff that you can just download from the internet onto it. You do need to purchase an SD card, apparently, to get extra storage space, because there's a limited amount on the internal hard drive. But I mean, it's like another $50.
Oh, definitely worth it, especially as big as these cards are now. Like,
yeah, I bought one of those like 200 gigabytes for $70. And I mean, I'll install it in a little bit later, but of the, all the digital content you can get, including things like Street Fighter, which is going to be a digital download, and not something like not a cartridge you pull in.
And you haven't finished creating it yet, though, but there is the shop, just like the old Wii. So there are hopefully the old library of old Nintendo classic games. So unless you want, you buy a little NES system, you could obviously download it on that.
It's kind of what this is coming into,
yeah, and take that with you anywhere. So
as far as the review for Zelda Breath of the Wild, really fun game. I would say if you're going to buy a video game for the Nintendo Switch, buy that game, especially if you enjoy Zelda. Because it's, again, it's not revolutionary as far as like video games, but it's a it's a big leap forward for that particular franchise. You get crafting, you can make food and potions, and the weapons you get degrade and break, so you have to actually go out and look for weapons or take them from your enemies as you kill them. And again, there's no load screen besides the initial one, so you can just, once you get in the game, you can go anywhere, and the game doesn't stop you from doing anything. You might die, it might be a stupid thing to do, but it won't stop you. Like, you can experiment, and you can figure out all the different things. Like, you can use the axe to chop down trees and turn it into fire, but unless you were experimenting, you don't know that. You don't figure it out. Exactly. Like, there's very little hand-holding here, but it kind of gives you a bunch of tools and says, oh, figure out how to live and survive, and if you go into certain areas, like a cold area, and you don't have fire, you just die.
Yeah.
Like, it'll, like, gradually break down your health until you figure out, oh, I had to carry a torch with me that's lit on fire so that I don't freeze to death. Or I had to figure out how to create a campfire. And once you create a campfire, oh, then I can maybe find a pot and cook with it and make extra good meals that give me better health, or potions that give me abilities, or different bonuses. And there's a lot of that kind of stuff where it's very much discovery oriented, and they encourage you to explore and experiment and explore, which is not the case with other Zelda games. Like, they're very puzzle oriented. And the weapons were very, like, you had to have a certain weapon to accomplish a task. And there's a little bit of that here with the puzzle rooms, but a lot of it's just, here are some tools, you decide how you're going to do this, and it very much becomes an experience of like, discovery. And there being multiple ways to accomplish a goal. And the game doesn't care what you do, but it gives you all, and everything works really smoothly, and lets you kind of figure it out for yourself, which is kind of cool, and I'm enjoying myself. Even though I'm still in the beginning part of it, and I've only played for a couple hours, it's definitely the best Nintendo game I've played in, like, years.
Yeah, don't get me wrong with the Wind Waker and all of the Mask of Majora, all those other Legend of Zelda games. Hell, the only games that I played, at least for Zelda-wise, was, of course, the originals for the NES system. Super, the Link to the Past one was fun, was an excellent one for me. But this one was good. I just wasn't too crazy, you know, when it started becoming more of the, you know, 3D environments and exploring.
Yeah.
I always feel like, in a way, it was, like, too much. But it was, in a way, you had to evolve with it. Because for gamers, like I'm one of the old school gamers, it's all about a 2D screen where you just, you know, flat against going up and down, left and right. But now that you got the whole 360 experience, it's a lot more fun. I feel like, especially with my imagination, I'll be doing some weird kind of combos, putting things together. I'll be
sticking
things to arrows and just launching.
Try it out. It'll work or it won't. I mean, but that's kind of the thing. Like, there's some really weird discoveries. Apparently, if you want spoilers on all the crafting stuff, you can look on the internet.
Oh, yeah.
I think half the fun is figuring it out and, like, sharing it with your wife or your cousins or your friends or whatever in, like, a small group. Like, that sense of discovery and nice and new is kind of reinserted into this particular Zelda game, which the franchise hasn't had in a really long time, in my opinion.
Oh, yeah.
Like, they're not bad games. It's just that they've been very similar throughout the last 3 or 4 games.
If remember, though, it's not out yet, but they did show that one teaser trailer video of that one new Mario game where his hat has little eyeballs and he uses
it like a boomerang. I don't know that that's going to be a huge thing, but I do think it's cool that they're experimenting.
Yeah.
So I can't wait to see another Mario game on the Nintendo Switch as well.
Which, that's a part that's always a trip out. Usually when the new Nintendo system comes with.
Right.
Usually a Mario game would be
out. Yeah, but again, if you can't get it now, because it is kind of rare in some stores, they're saying during Christmas season, they're going to start doing bundles again with, like, so if you buy the Nintendo Switch you'll get a free game with it.
Yeah.
So it's probably going to be their mini game, which is Switch 1, 2, 3 or whatever it is, mm-hmm. where there's a bunch of mini games that use the controllers, just like the Wii Sports was for the Nintendo Wii.
I just definitely want to see the library once we get you get the account up.
Yeah, we'll set it up later.
But see what they have available. But I'm guessing NES, SNES, and some of the old stuff. Just everything that you saw on the Wii.
Yeah, basically. And download it and see if it works.
All right, real quick. Do you think it will... Sorry. Real quick. Do you think they're done with the 3DSs and all that? Now, this will be...
They said they were.
So, still...
Yeah, they're going to stop production of those because this is going to be a better console. They don't... Apparently, they're like, oh, people don't care about 3D. Which is true.
Yeah. On the consoles, and attach it on, but...
Yeah, if anything, they're going to start investigating and doing prototyping for virtual reality instead of just the 3D picture from a screen, which makes more sense because then it's a much more inclusive environmental kind of 3D.
It's light enough. If they make the headset, just pop in your Switch.
Yeah, you could. It's not a horrible screen to do it with, but it's definitely not intended for. You can tell design-wise that it's not its primary purpose. It would be much better to use it as a processor and or just make something new and have your own virtual reality headset. That would be a much better way to have a good product. But the PlayStation released their numbers for the PSVR. And apparently, they're on track to sell 1 million units within the next month. And so that currently actually out of stock.
Hopefully, they lower the price on that thing. That's because you had the one it's buy not, the console, two buy
it's another. It's still cheaper than the other ones. Because if you think of like the, this is again off topic, guys. But if you think about the other virtuality experiences like Oculus or Vive, they're with the controllers and the headset, they're like $700-$800.
Wow.
Even though Oculus just dropped their price by $200, they're still expensive. They're still $600 just for that setup. And that's not including the PC that runs them. And you're looking at a decent VR computer system at being $800-$1,000 by itself. And so that on top of the $600. I mean, you're talking about $1,600-$1,700 for a virtual reality system as opposed to the PlayStation, which is all included with the virtual reality stuff, is going to be like $400 or $500. So that's probably why they're selling a lot more than the other guys, because they're just less expensive. Plus, you get a good console system.
There's been a big, not a big debatable thing about it. It's like, depending on this, if you're a homebody, awesome. But some people are debating about, like, you know, home gaming, home this, home, unless it's mobile. People are missing out on the real world experiences compared to playing virtual.
That's just a cultural shift. But virtual reality, if anything, is going to get you up off your butt and moving around.
That's true.
So there is that aspect of it as well.
Yeah,
I mean, but these are all cultural questions we're gonna have to answer as we enter the age of virtual reality.
We'll get there. Once eventually we get that plug in the back.
It'll figure itself out. Yeah, yeah. There we go. Okay, on to movie trailer showdown.
Yeah.
Three trailers enter. One leaves the winner, my friends. We have three trailers: DuckTales, Alien Covenant, and Deadpool. Which of these three do you pick? Deadpool? Okay. Deadpool is actually my answer as well. I like the Alien Covenant one, but compared to the Deadpool trailer, it just wasn't as awesome.
Yeah.
So
it was just amazing. The biggest thing for me, and don't get me wrong, the jokes, the Ryan Reynolds just being Ryan Reynolds and all that, was the... I don't know if I want to call it legal rights or whatever, but they played the Superman intro for him to get changed into the phone booth.
Which means they bought it.
Yeah.
Just like they bought that soundtrack stuff for the first Deadpool, you have to buy the music rights before you can use them. So they totally got that stuff.
I don't know. I feel like it's not necessarily a kick in DC in the balls, but you know, you're literally taking Superman's intro music, the Chris Reeves, you know, that movie, and the phone booth, which is iconic once again of him, you know, changing into. And it's like, I don't want to say they dropped the gauntlet right there, like, you know, what's up, DC? But I wonder if they're going to come up with their own, like, you know, try to make a knockoff, you know, Wolverine, like, who has fucking claws?
Wolverine jokes in this movie. If you look at the
in DC stuff?
No, in this thing here. Trailer. No, but you see the Logan movie above the phone booth on the. I forget what it's called, where they say now showing. Showing above, it says Wolverine.
Yeah.
And then on the thing, the writing here, it says something about something Summers.
Yeah. So there's a bunch of jokes
and teasers in there. Yeah. I especially like the commentary. If you watch the YouTube video with the commentary track or the closed captioning, mm-hmm. you get a bunch of additional comments from Ryan Reynolds.
Yeah.
Like, why the hell is Deadpool taking so long to change? What the F, man? Or we'd like to see this character, you know, person as whatever character.
Take it from a guy that actually has a Deadpool costume and trying to put it on. It was kind of funny because, like, the way he had, like, the swords already attached to the jacket-ish kind of thing.
It's like, that would save you time.
Oh, my God. Because I have a hard time when I was putting on a morph suit of Deadpool costume, just zipping up the zipper on the back. So I kind of understand now why ladies, I was, can you do me and zip me up in the back?
Yep.
Because I had to make my own little contraption to zip myself up, almost like a wetsuit. And, of course, not even including the weapons. I had my own little holster and all that kind of stuff on it, so I can understand it taking him forever to, you know, it's not like Superman where he's already wearing it under his clothes and he just rips open the shirt and like, I'm good to go kind of deal.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. But like I said, that's definitely the big winner for me as well. It's a hilarious trailer. Go watch it it's actually on YouTube. There was like a cam version of it that popped up and was quickly squashed. And then Ryan was like, oh, it's already been leaked, so we might as well show it ourselves. But it's also playing before Logan.
Yeah.
So which we're going to watch later today. You can today.
Enjoy it on the big screen.
So there you go.
But what did you think of DuckTales?
It was okay. I like the art style. It was very, very good.
Yeah,
like, the voices were sort of hit and miss. It felt very much like it was geared towards young kids, preteens. But I'll have to wait and see. It also looks a little more action oriented according to the trailer. But again, these are all early impressions. We don't know.
Yeah, it's all in the art style. I don't know if you've seen the current Mickey Mouse cartoons that are out right now. It's in that style art form, which I'm not complaining. Fine, yeah. It was fine. It's like Disney's version of Ren and Stimpy cartoons.
Sort of.
Because they'll do some weird kind of like kind of things and they'll show crazy.
No, there's definitely stylized. It's not the old 1950s artwork.
Exactly. And so it's stylized for this era, if you will. So it's good. I'm gonna check it out. The voice is kind of funny. The biggest thing for me, I got happy when I saw Launchpad McQuack, but I can't wait till they show Gizmo Duck. Gizmo Duck is my main thing.
And it's probably going to be a season 2 thing.
Yeah, well, hopefully. If not, at least make a teaser, show the guy in there. And at least for Alien Covenant.
It was cool. It's another alien I like the movie. Fact that you get to see the alien at the end. And it was the actual alien you were expecting. Not the one from
the weird, deforming first
round. Prometheus.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm like, okay. I mean, not that I thought it was a bad movie, but people went to it expecting to see an alien movie, and it wasn't. It was very much a standalone prequel film that just happens to be in the same universe. Yeah. And this one is definitely an alien movie, and it's set before the first aliens, but there's still aliens in there. And I think that's going to be, this is definitely more of a suspense horror thriller.
Totally, yeah.
Which I'm happy for. I'm happy that the franchise is going back to that concept and not trying to just be something it's not.
Yeah, because I love that's the thing that I loved about the movie experience. It sucks you in because it always builds that suspense when they're going down like a dark corridor.
Yep.
And you just hear like dripping of like water or something, then out of nowhere, poof, you know, it comes right at you. And
Ah!
Yep. Love that experience.
There you go. Okay, that's it for the show, everyone. Thanks a lot for watching the podcast. If you want to help support us, you can always visit us at
geekbytespodcast.com/support.
That's it. Again, for the podcast, for Geek Bytes Podcast, I am Ramon Mejia. This guy is...
I'm Edgardo Acosta.
And remember, folks, to go geek out about something.